Think and Grow Rich, The Richest Man in Babylon, As a Man Thinketh, and The Science of Getting Rich, The Business, Motivation, and Leadership Collection. By Napoleon Hill, George S. Clason, James Allen, and Wallace D. Wattles.
Think and Grow Rich, written by Napoleon Hill, narrated by Russell Newton. What do you want most? Is it money? Fame? Power? Contentment? Personality? Peace of mind? Happiness? The 13 steps to riches described in this book offer the shortest dependable philosophy of individual achievement ever presented for the benefit of the man or woman who is searching for a definite goal in life. Before beginning the book, you will profit greatly if you recognize the fact that the book was not written to entertain. You cannot digest the contents properly in a week or a month. After reading the book thoroughly, Dr. Miller Reese Hutchison, nationally known consulting engineer and longtime associate of Thomas A. Edison, said, "This is not a novel. It is a textbook on individual achievement that came directly from the experiences of hundreds of America's most successful men. It should be studied, digested, and meditated upon. No more than one chapter should be read in a single night. The reader should underline the sentences which impress him most. Later, he should go back to these marked lines and read them again. A real student will not merely read this book. He will absorb its contents and make them his own. The book should be adopted by all high schools, and no boy or girl should be permitted to graduate without having satisfactorily passed an examination on it. This philosophy will not take the place of the subjects taught in schools, but it will enable one to organize and apply the knowledge acquired and convert it into useful service and adequate compensation without waste of time." Dr. John R. Turner, Dean of the College of the City of New York, after having read the book, said, "The very best example of the soundness of this philosophy is your own son, Blair, whose dramatic story you have outlined in the chapter on desire." Dr. Turner had reference to the author's son, who, born without normal hearing capacity, not only avoided becoming a deaf mute, but actually converted his handicap into a priceless asset by applying the philosophy here described. After reading the story, starting on page 52, you'll realize that you are about to come into possession of a philosophy which can be transmuted into material wealth, or serve as readily to bring you peace of mind, understanding, spiritual harmony, and in some instances, as in the case of the author's son, it can help you master physical affliction. The author discovered, through personally analyzing hundreds of successful men, that all of them followed the habit of exchanging ideas through what is commonly called conferences. When they had problems to be solved, they sat down together and talked freely until they discovered, from their joint contribution of ideas, a plan that would serve their purpose. You who read this book will get most out of it by putting into practice the mastermind principle described in the book. This you can do, as others are doing so successfully, by forming a study club, consisting of any desired number of people who are friendly and harmonious. The club should have a meeting at regular periods, as often as once each week. The procedure should consist of reading one chapter of the book at each meeting, after which the contents of the chapter should be freely discussed by all members. Each member should make notes, putting down all ideas of his own inspired by the discussion. Each member should carefully read and analyze each chapter several days prior to its open reading and joint discussion in the club. The reading at the club should be done by someone who reads well and understands how to put color and feeling into the lines. By following this plan, every reader will get from its pages not only the sum total of the best knowledge organized from the experiences of hundreds of successful men, but more importantly by far, he will tap new sources of knowledge in his own mind, as well as acquire knowledge of priceless value from every other person present. If you follow this plan persistently, you will be almost certain to uncover and appropriate the secret formula by which Andrew Carnegie acquired his huge fortune, as referred to in the author's introduction. Tributes to the author from great American leaders. Think and Grow Rich was 25 years in the making, It is Napoleon Hill's newest book, based upon his famous Law of Success philosophy. His work and writings have been praised by great leaders in finance, education, politics, government. Supreme Court of the United States, Washington, D.C. Dear Mr. Hill, I have now had an opportunity to finish reading your Law of Success textbooks, and I wish to express my appreciation of the splendid work you have done in the organization of this philosophy. It would be helpful if every politician in the country would assimilate and apply the 17 principles on which your lessons are based. It contains some very fine material, which every leader in every walk of life should understand. I am happy to have had the privilege of rendering you some slight measure of help in the organization of this splendid course of common sense philosophy. Sincerely yours, William Taft, former President and former Chief Justice of the United States. King of the 5 and 10 cent stores. By applying many of the 17 fundamentals of the Law of Success philosophy, we have built a great chain of successful stores. I presume it would be no exaggeration of fact if I said that the Woolworth Building might properly be called a monument to the soundness of these principles. F.W. Woolworth. A great steamship magnate. I feel greatly indebted for the privilege of reading your Law of Success. If I had had this philosophy 50 years ago, I suppose I could have accomplished all that I have done in less than half the time. I sincerely hope the world will discover and reward you. Robert Dollar. Famous American labor leader. Mastery of the Law of Success philosophy is the equivalent of an insurance policy against failure. Samuel Gompers. A former president of the United States. May I not congratulate you on your persistence? Any man who devotes that much time must, of necessity, make discoveries of great value to others. I am deeply impressed by your interpretation of the mastermind principles which you have so clearly described. Woodrow Wilson. A merchant prince. I know that your 17 fundamentals of success are sound because I've been applying them in my business for more than 30 years. John Wanamaker. World's largest maker of cameras. I know that you're doing a world of good with your Law of Success. I would not care to set a monetary value on this training because it brings to the student qualities which cannot be measured by money alone. George Eastman. A nationally known business chief. Whatever success I may have attained, I owe entirely to the application of your 17 principles of the Law of Success. I believe I have the honor of being your first student. W. M. Wrigley, Jr. Author's Preface. In every chapter of this book, mention has been made of the money-making secret which has made fortunes for more than 500 exceedingly wealthy men, whom I have carefully analyzed over a long period of years. The secret was brought to my attention by Andrew Carnegie more than a quarter of a century ago. The canny, lovable old Scotsman carelessly tossed it into my mind when I was but a boy. Then he sat back in his chair with a merry twinkle in his eyes and watched carefully to see if I had brains enough to understand the full significance of what he had said to me. When he saw that I had grasped the idea, he asked if I would be willing to spend 20 years or more preparing myself to take it out to the world, to men and women who, without the secret, might go through life as failures. I said I would, and with Mr. Carnegie's cooperation, I have kept my promise. This book contains the secret, after having been put to a practical test by thousands of people, in almost every walk of life. It was Mr. Carnegie's idea that the magic formula, which gave him a stupendous fortune, ought to be placed within reach of people who do not have time to investigate how men make money. And it was his hope that I might test and demonstrate the soundness of the formula through the experience of men and women in every calling. He believed the formula should be taught in all public schools and colleges, and expressed the opinion that if it were properly taught, it would so revolutionize the entire educational system that the time spent in school could be reduced to less than half. His experience with Charles M. Schwab and other young men of Mr. Schwab's type convinced Mr. Carnegie that much of that which is taught in the schools is of no value whatsoever.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.